Good morning. Seems lately, I'm laughing every time I start a blab. Not quite sure what that's about. I'm Elaine Lindsay of True Social Media. Good morning. Good morning. I'm here with my co-host, Patricia Wall of TTLO Inc. We call her the holistic missile, and it won't take you long to figure out why.
Well, I think it's good that we're laughing when we start. That's what we want to
Oh,
be doing.
absolutely, absolutely. But it's like there's some little joke that we're not letting people in on. I've watched the last few blabs I've done, and it always starts with hee hee hee.
That's a good thing. Well, they can tune in and find out what's going on.
Well, yes, but it's kind of weird when that's how the show starts when you replay it. So people are wondering, I wonder what we missed.
Well,
What happened before? There's
I
nothing.
can honestly say that, well, t it's not nothing. Typically, right before we go on, we say, well, what are we talking about today? And we look at the schedule and we say,
I go,
here's our topic.
oh
And
yeah?
then we wisecrack about it because that's what we do.
Yeah,
And
that's true.
so chances are we're wisecracking about our actual topic. So today, we
True.
said May, we were going to talk about goals. Everything in May will be about goals, and today we're going to talk about trying. Because when you're trying to achieve goals, it means there's a problem.
When you're trying to do anything, it means there's a problem.
Yes,
I
it
have learned
means
that much.
you have learned that much. You've learned a lot. So what it means, if you are trying, it means that your goals are conflicted. And that's true for anything. If you're quote trying to do it, it means that you have an internal conflict. And what that means is that some subconscious part of you doesn't want it. And we always have a challenge with this because we think we want it. And the think part is cognitive brain. Think part is that modern cognitive brain understands the world very differently than the subconscious does. So if you're trying, people always say, well, I have to have a chance to achieve it. So let's say 3 months. If you've been trying for 3 months and it hasn't happened, then you really need to take a step back. And the first thing to do is admit to yourself that you don't actually want it.
Ooh. Sorry, I'm going to tweet that out because that's cool. For 3 months, you don't really want
Right? And the automatic reaction is, of course I do. This is the goal I made. This is the thing that I believe that I want. And so it's really hard to tell the truth, take a step back and say, no, you don't. Because if you really wanted it, you'd have it. You'd have
Oh,
it.
absolutely. And I can say, good morning, Pat. Good morning, Kim. Nice to see you. I know that Pat, the same as me, will go back because Pat and I both have worked with you for a very long time. But I used to get furious with you when you'd tell me, well, no, if you're trying, you just don't want it. And it's like, what do you mean I don't want it? I know I want it. I want it. I'm right here. I want it. And then it was, damn it.
And
Someone
not only
really
do I want it,
doesn't
but I'm working really hard.
care.
I'm doing all sorts of things to get it. And it's still
And
not working.
I've, well, a couple of things I've learned is it's always better to reassess and understand if you're working that hard, something's not clicking.
Yes.
Because when it's right, it's easy.
Easy.
It's smooth. It
Right?
flows.
Yep. And that doesn't mean you don't do hard work. The
No,
thing is, it doesn't
no.
feel hard because it's easy and it's smooth and you get that gratification, that success feeling because it is working. Right?
And I know this is a sort of simplistic way of looking at things, but there's a whole bunch of proponents out there of going with the flow. And truly, okay, if you are now, this is sort of a weird analogy because of who you're talking to, but if you're in a canoe or a kayak,
Okay.
it's a lot easier to paddle if you're going with the flow of the river. If you're going upstream, you're going to find it really difficult. Now, it's highly unlikely that I'm ever going to be in a canoe or kayak. A yacht, yes, but those two, not my thing. However, just, all kidding aside, it does make it simpler if you use what it's saying. When you go with the flow, you're using the resources that are available to you. If you just, open your eyes, open your heart, open your you, and you can actually be able to use those resources. It's not that you're sitting on your laurels doing nothing. It's that you're congruent with what you're doing. Woohoo!
Good.
I sound like you.
Woohoo! Woohoo! So now let's talk to the rebels, because there's a whole bunch of rebels going, I'm not a go with the flow person. I have to march to my own drummer, all of those songs, right? So here's what happens. We're hardwired for three threat reactions in the subconscious: fight and flight, run away, freeze and hide. Rebel is a freeze and hide reaction, and it is a withdrawal from requirements. And it often happens because people are not the fitting kind of person, and that's okay. I'm not a fitting kind of person either. And it's
I'm definitely not.
definitely not. Okay. And so when you understand you're not a fitting kind of person, it can be difficult to imagine that if you go with, like, if I go with the flow, that then I'm the fit in person. It doesn't have to be that.
No.
Right? It doesn't have to be that at all. It's understanding you can be different and you can walk to a different drummer. It doesn't mean you have to fight. Now, the hard part is the wiring says you do. The wiring says it has to be the hard way. The wiring says that the norm then becomes an opponent, as opposed to understanding the norm. And so here's an example. I can be walking to my own drummer and still have CAA. So that if I, or AAA, so that if I happen to get a flat or something, I can call and get somebody else to take care of it for me. This is the thing, is that it's understanding I can be aware of resources and I can use those resources. It doesn't mean I have to conform to normal.
No, absolutely, absolutely. And I think, in my case, because I'm very literal, I do tend to be very aware of my languaging, because words like try and the word but, years and years ago, you said, yep, well, you say but, everything that happened before the but is a
It's
lie.
canceled.
It no longer makes sense, or it's not relevant. And that really made me think, because there are very few times, unless you're making a point and using but, blah blah blah, but okay, if you're making a point, it's fine. But every other time, I so would not use the word but, because why bother saying all the stuff that came before?
There's
You're just
no point.
negating it.
It's the story you're telling yourself, right?
Yeah.
It's the story. So we go, okay, when you have rebel going on, you will find that either resources are expensive, or they come with a hidden price, or you find that they just aren't there for you. They don't come through for you. When you're in rebel, you'll find that everything takes more effort than it really seems it should. It takes longer than it seems it should. And all of those things mean that there's a place where, you're just not operating from love. And that sounds so corny, right? It sounds so corny. The thing is, the more you get out of that fear state into the love state, the easier things go, the easier things come to you. And, frankly, it's you will accomplish more in your day, in your efforts. Now that, at the risk of sounding all new age, what do I mean by that? What do I mean by coming from love? And it's literally the opposite of coming from fear. Because if you're thinking, I need, I want, I have to, I should, all of those things are coming from fear. So if you observe your thoughts and think, oh, well, I have to get this done, or I need to meet this quota, or I, you know, I should be doing this other thing to make things work. All of that is coming from a place of fear. And even if you, you know, even if you're not interested in the energy of it, understand that if you're interacting with clients, if you're interacting with customers, if you've got that vibe, they can feel it.
Yeah.
They can feel it. You know, even if you don't think, like, if you're not interested in energy, just think about, you do have a kind of vibe when you're interacting with people.
Well, some people say, like, fear has a smell. Desperation
right?
has.
Right.
And those are, it's a really good point. And it takes, it doesn't come overnight. Being aware, whether you believe in energy or not, being aware of how what you say and how you say it is affecting your clients, your customers, it's important that you're always paying attention. And, you know, it takes a long time to make a point of not just knee-jerk reaction for whatever happens. And I can say that very honestly, because I've been working with Trish since 2004. And just a couple of months ago, I was ready to react to something, smart enough to catch myself and reach out to Trish and say, okay, well, this is what I want to say. And Trish took the whole thing and turned it up on its head so that my little rebel reaction was no longer required. It was actually kind of stupid.
you know, it's just natural. It's natural.
Oh, yeah.
Because it is, and that's, we are hardwired for threat reactions.
Yeah.
It takes real awareness of self to overcome that. And you have to build new pathways for your brain, right? These hardwired threat reactions, they are that. You know, you come with those. And so you have to build new pathways to give your brain somewhere else to go. And, you know, you do really well. I mean, most of the time, you're just, like, you've done enough work, you know, like, you just don't go there anymore. And so this one caught you unawares. It just found something you hadn't cleared yet, and then it was easy. You just clear it. Right? The thing is, you knew.
Well, yeah, it's nice to be in a place where I can stop, you know, take that time. I don't just, you know, fire off responses to things if I find myself
having a reaction, right?
Or really, yeah, really pissed off about something. It's like, okay, yeah, step away. You cannot handle this right now. And I'm not saying that there's never a place for, there are times. We talked in our last show about when it's time to fire a client. I mean, there are times where, you know, your anger or well, not so much your anger, but your consideration may be to let go of a situation rather than continue. And yeah, not so much in the anger, because that's more a reaction than it is actually.
Yeah, thinking. It's not strategy,
see,
right?
I'm getting see? Better. I'm
see?
Getting better.
Right? You know? So I want to go back to trying. So when you feel like, okay, I know what I want and I'm working, you know, and I'm doing it. And so sometimes it feels like, you know, if I'm really wanting this goal, why aren't I doing the things I need to do to get it? Sometimes it feels like that. And sometimes it feels like your nose is to the grindstone and you're doing everything you can to get it. And you're still not getting it. Right. And sometimes people don't know what their goals are. And that's a thing for another show, because what we're doing today is, you know, what if you're trying? So you believe it's what you want. What if you believe it's what you want and you find like you're not doing the thing that needs to be done? Okay. You're not delivering on time, or you're finding you're just too tired, or you can't get focused, or you're procrastinating. You know, all of, like, there's lots of behaviors that are reaction behaviors. Okay. Anytime you're procrastinating, anytime you find like you're making silly mistakes, things that you think like, why would I do this? You're forgetting, you know, like things that you call yourself wrong for. And you look, it looks like you're sabotaging yourself. So if you're, quote, doing the thing and you're sabotaging yourself, then what it is you have the part of you that believes you want the goal, and then there's a subconscious part of you that's going, you can't make me. That's it, exactly. You can't make me. Now, chances are really good that if you let yourself pay attention to the chatter in your head, the voice of that part of you that doesn't want it is there telling you exactly why you don't want it. And you just ignore it or squish it or say, we know better. So it could be, oh, you know, if I got this really big contract, I'm going to be really busy. And that's going to have an impact on my personal life. Or I won't be able to keep up with it. Or then I'm setting a new standard I'm not sure I want to have. And all of those concerns, we dismiss them. It'll be fine. It'll be fine. I'll hire more people. I'll make it work, or like whatever it is that you use to justify ignoring what is in fact a concern. And lots of times the concerns are not rational. Lots of times they're not rational, so it's automatic to dismiss them because you know think that doesn't make any sense. I'll be fine. So it's more difficult to pause and say, I have to treat this like a real concern and address it, because if I don't, then it becomes self-sabotage. It becomes self-sabotage. You know, I have tools, you know, you can use Campfire to go in and find out what is the voice of the naysayer. You can find out what those are and find out what they need. The key thing is to recognize that for your subconscious, it's always going to be about protecting you, protecting you, protecting your tribe, protecting your status. It's always about that. If you know that, then you can recognize where the interruption is and address it. So, for instance, people always say, oh, I really should go to the gym, and then I get too tired or I get too busy or whatever, whatever, you know. The thing is, it means that the subconscious part of you doesn't want to go to the gym,
Well,
regardless of what,
because our subconscious doesn't like change.
right? So it's understanding what is the thing that is in conflict with going to the gym. So it can be resistance to change. It can be resistance to taking care of yourself because you've been taught to take care of everybody else. It can be resistance to wellness because then you'll make other demands of yourself. Right? So, you know, we say, oh, it's resistance to change. And what is it about the change? Is it because you'll raise the bar? Is it because you're busy being sacrificial, taking care of everybody in the world except you? Is it because you've been trained that right is to be tired all the time? And if you go to the gym and get more healthy, you can't be tired all the time, and then you can't meet that definition of right.
Well, yeah, we all have sort of subconscious images of ourself, if you will, which are our stories, that kind of put the boundaries, if you will, on how we act and what we do, and you know, because we all have labels for ourselves. Okay, I'm a wife, I'm a mother, I'm a glandma. I'm a fur kid mom. I'm a fur kid grandma. You know, I'm a business person. But for many years, I was a chronically ill person. And I am no longer, which is really kind of cool.
It is.
And we the royal we are quite congruent with that, because I'm happier, I'm better served to be serving my clients than to hang on to what's no longer serving me. And wow, it took a long time to get there.
Well, you had to get well enough too to get there, right? Because
But
if you start out chronically ill, you got to kind of climb out of that pit before you can start reshaping everything, right?
Oh, absolutely. And but that goes for any of the labels that we have. You know, people that are in accounting, okay, they have a label that's they're detail oriented, they're very, you know, finance focused. And even that label can be detrimental because you're not allowing for the other pieces of you.
Yes.
You know, just because you're an accountant doesn't mean you can't be creative. There are accountants who paint, okay, who, you know, maybe you're also an amazing golfer.
Yeah.
Like we have so many facets, there's so many labels that make up one human. This is a whole new thing about not letting any one label define us.
Yes.
You know, the labels should be, okay, see, they shouldn't be labels anymore. They should be modifiers.
Choices.
Yeah, choices.
Oh, forms, I like that. Of expression.
Yeah.
Ways that's thing. Express.
Finding some of those labels we are unaware of and maybe don't want to acknowledge. Oh, hell yeah. Well, yeah, because Pat, and you've known me long enough, if someone had said to me, you know, you are presenting with this label and, you know, showing off your label of the chronically ill person, I would have been pissed. I might have hit somebody. I don't really mean it that way because I couldn't beat my way out of a wet paper bag. But I would have been offended because you're absolutely right. It's not something I would have wanted to acknowledge. And it was, you know, a lot of work has to be done for you to see these things for sure.
Well, so now let's go to roles because we have lots of roles. You listed off lots of them, you know, business person, wife, mother, grandmother, for kid mom. If you allow other people to define those roles, and other people can be social expectations, you know, social expectations of what it means to be mom or means to be wife or whatever. If you allow others to define that, you will always be in seek. Always. You have to be. Because regardless of how clearly you think you understand it, you know, regardless of what you believe about that, it's somebody else's definition. So you can't fulfill it. So a key piece to feeling the ability to succeed and giving yourself the ability to succeed is for you to define your requirements of yourself in all of your roles, whatever they may be. As you do that, as you get comfortable doing that, what happens is you get comfortable defining yourself and then the roles no longer define you. Right. You become free of that and you say, you know, I'm a person and this is all of the ways I express myself. I express myself as a mother. I express myself as a fur mom. I express myself in my forms of creativity and in my business. These are ways I express myself. These are my choices. As opposed to all the attachments we make, like think of all the things that are associated with mom, good Lord, good and bad, right? You know, and my boys were here on the weekend and somebody said something and one of them joked, you're supposed to apply guilt here. And I said, me, you know, like not my thing to apply guilt, frankly. But it was a joke because that's a mom thing. Right, it's an association with mom.
Well, yeah, as my son says it. Oh, pack your bags, we're going on a guilt trip.
See, right, and it's allowing yourself to be free of all that. Yeah. Allowing yourself to be free of all that requires that you define the roles, and you have to define the roles for yourself, and then do the work. I mean, there's a free unlock on the website you can get to peel out the stuff that has been internalized that you've accepted from other people about how to fulfill those roles. And you have to
throwback, gotta say it. Okay. You have to be in your driver's seat to be able to make choice.
Yes.
Any choice.
Well, it's a very interesting concept to be in the driver's seat. And
let me
give people the in a can. You know how sometimes you drive home from work and you end up in the driveway and you realize you can't remember the drive. You weren't in the driver's seat. I mean, clearly your subconscious knows how to drive a car, or you decide you're going to stop on the way home from work and pick up something, you know, milk, eggs, dry cleaning, whatever. And then you end up in the driveway and realize you didn't do that. Even though you decided to do it, you didn't do it. And this is a very practical demonstration of not being in your own driver's seat. Some other part of you usurped. You most likely, if you're driving, you were operating on automatic and you just did the automatic drive home. So
getting... But it's a euphemism in the driver's seat. It doesn't mean necessarily...
Driving. That's right.
You're driving.
That's
anywhere.
Right. And so always you can see the evidence of the subconscious when you make a decision to do something and then you don't do it.
Yeah.
And that's where that metaphor comes from, because we can see it easily when we do the automatic drive home. The thing is, it operates everywhere in our lives. So now we go back to, we talked about when you are doing stuff, you know, you look like you're working really hard towards this goal that you're, quote, trying to achieve. The other piece is if you think you're not doing it, that you're too tired or you forgot or, right? So if you find like you feel like you're self-sabotaging, you're not doing the things that you intended to do, again, it means that you're conflicted about the goal and there's something you're resisting and you don't know that because you think, the cognitive brain thinks this is the goal you want. One of the easy ways to understand this is to understand that it isn't just about what you think, because the subconscious talks to you through emotion. The voice of your subconscious is in your body, and you don't think emotion, you feel emotion.
Okay, I need to stop you because I think this is really important. Carlton said it's also a good example of Alzheimer's or ADHD. And Carlton, buckle up. You're in for a ride here. Trish?
I have three sons. I have two ADHD and one ADD. I'm pretty convinced that I have ADHD too, except I've done so much work that it, you know, it's kind of irrelevant because I function the way I want to function, if you will. So I'm a firm believer. I'm going to go there. I'm a firm believer that things like autism and ADHD are all symptoms of a psychic ability that hasn't been trained. That these are brains that interact with the world. They get told they're supposed to interact a specific way, and you know that's not how they take in information. That's not how they interact with the world. So I find that as people learn how to shield, how to allow themselves to have clear thoughts without being bombarded by what's around them, it change their ability to function changes dramatically. Obviously, there are levels, you know, and some people are starting out in a what many people would consider not functional. And yet I find if you connect with them where they are, they can go there.
But can you address, okay, she did not say Alzheimer's in that group.
I didn't.
Address that piece for me, please.
Okay. So here's what happens.
Well said. Sorry, Amy, just before you go on that thought, Amy says she loves that thought. She is intuitive in ways that most people aren't, and she's highly ADHD.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And I think it's all a continuum, you know, and autism is the more extreme. You know, ADHD is on the autism spectrum.
Yeah.
So it's all about levels. So let's go back to Alzheimer's. So here's what happens. Okay, let me give some context, because I was going, where do I start with that? I had a severe brain injury. So I was in a four-car pileup, had a severe brain injury, and then suddenly I had all of these gifts. I have it. All of these intuitive gifts open up because of the brain injury. There were things that happened with my memory. There were things that happened with how my brain was wired. And because of the brain injury, lots of the pathways that existed before the accident didn't exist after. And I have worked with other people who have had brain injuries. So the kind of thing that happens is you go, I would like some thing on my toast, and your word, like the word jam, won't retrieve. Or you say, I would like some pencils on my toast, because your brain goes somewhere unexpected. This kind of gapping is the kind of thing you see with Alzheimer's. So you could say, well, okay, is it physical? There's always a physical element. The thing is, with all the physical elements, you can still correct it. So, you know, doctors told me I was going to be like that for the rest of my life. At that point, I couldn't string two sentences together. People would say to me that sometimes I spoke coherently and other times I spoke like the words had been put through a blender. All of that was corrected with energy work. Okay, I did use like various homeopathic remedies and essential oils and things. The thing is, the bottom line was the energy work that hooked it all together and drew me to the right places. So when your brain won't retrieve, you know, if you think you need pencils on your toast, or if that's what you actually think you need jam, but you know, what comes out of your mouth is pencils, there's a wiring problem. There's a wiring problem. And huge parts of what I'm teaching people when I'm teaching them self-mastery is to literally change the wiring. So for example, if you have a threat reaction, so what I'm saying is you're wired for these threat reactions, and what we want to do is change the wiring so you have other choices. You have a different choice besides just having a threat reaction. You have a different choice besides having the knee-jerk reaction you typically have. So pause and consider, you know, a great example is people have scripts in conversations and they do things on automatic, especially couples that have been together for a while. You know, one says this, the other one says the next thing, and the next thing you know, they're in a script and it's the same script they play out all the time. So we have a lot of patterns that are wired in. There are reasons those patterns get interrupted. There are physical symptoms that go with that. The thing is, you can rewire your own brain. We know this is a fact because, you know, you can do the Karate Kid wax on, wax off thing. You can train your brain to have specific physical reactions. You can learn new things. When you learn new things, you create new neural pathways. It's actually really easy to create new neural pathways. And so what we're doing is saying, do it deliberately. Make choices about where you put those pathways. Okay. Some of it is behavioral. In the same way that you would, you know, train a dog to a certain behavior, you can train yourself to a certain behavior. Most of it for me is about accessing choices that you don't realize are operating in patterns. So identifying the patterns that exist and saying, okay, I don't need to operate that way. I can have options. And it's all about getting the options and being able to access those and use those. So I believe that Alzheimer's is a result of trauma. I believe that it can be stopped and it can be rewired. The starting point would have to be teaching people to feel safe. Bottom line, teaching them to feel safe. Okay. A lot of people can't go there because they've never felt safe and they wouldn't know how to start. I believe that in order to feel safe, we require two things. One is believing we have the right resources to feel safe. And the other one is the ability to predict behavior. The ability to predict behavior. So, you know, I could feel safe sitting on the park bench next to an axe murderer if he only goes for redheads, because right now my hair's not red. It's been in the past. I wouldn't necessarily want to be sitting there, but if I know I'm not his flavor, then hey, right? I might decide I want to leave really quickly. Being able to predict behavior allows us the ability to succeed.
Okay. Okay, so let's take that back. Okay, we're heading back to business.
Okay.
Because that's all relevant in how you interact with your clients, your customers. Because in order for your clients to feel successful, you have to understand that there are possibilities of threat reactions. There is a distinct possibility that because you have expertise in an area that the client does not, then you're already in almost a
it's a given. You're going to trigger reactions.
You're going to trigger. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And I said, here's the thing. Your subconscious is wired for survival, and you will have hardwired threat reactions. I mean, unless you do brain retraining, which is, you know, obviously what I'm about, yeah. You're going to have hardwired threat reactions if it is perceived as a threat to you, a threat to your status, a threat to your tribe, you know, a threat to your ability to be part of your tribe, to take care of your tribe. And here's the thing, because we live in a civilized society, we don't think of things as threats. You know, if you go to meet a client to potentially take on a new client, you don't think of that as going to war. But your subconscious does, because this person with their decision about whether or not they're going to be your client, okay, they are giving you a direct return on your status, on your ability to contribute. And therefore on your well-being. So we don't think of that. And so training the brain so that you can actually come into that situation from love instead of fear, that's some serious rewiring.
Okay, I'll come back to that. Carlton said, believing it is fine and believing it can be fixed is all well and good. But is there any demonstrable scientific medical support or evidence to support those conclusions? Or is it all based on anecdotal evidence? But thanks in any case for taking the time to address the question. This just
I'm
before she
medical.
Gets into it, yeah, I'm going to say we're not taking this from a scientific medical perspective. In my case, I'm taking it from the fact that I was a chronically ill human being who slept basically 20 hours a day for decades. And I am now a functioning human being based on what I have done since 2004. So in both cases, Trish had her accident. I had a number of things that also.
Yeah, I only had one. You had four car accidents.
Yeah, yeah. And the car accidents weren't the bad thing. Anyway, the point being, there are a lot of pieces now, a lot of places in the scientific and medical communities that are saying, oh my God, we have to look at this because, okay, science has acknowledged that matter is energy. Energy exists. No denying it anymore. It is what it is. And from there, okay, Trish, go back to where you were.
The doctors told me I would be in the state I was in for the rest of my life. Clearly, I'm not. Clearly, I've been doing this for a long time. I've helped a lot of people have a different result than what was predicted by doctors. I have great respect for doctors. I wish everybody could work together, okay? Because, you know, if you break your leg, don't come to me.
Been there, done that.
Yeah, seriously. I think that there is a place for all of it, and it all needs to work together. You know, if your brain doesn't have the nutrition it needs, you can't function properly. So there's a lot of specialized stuff going on there that's really important. I've had lots of clients say to me, I want to go back to the doctors and tell them what you did. And I just say, no, I'm not interested. I'm not interested in having that conversation. I'm not interested. I got nothing to prove, right? And so I just don't tackle that. And that's okay. I think that all of it needs to work together. And always, you know, work with the doctors, work with the scientists. I do. I work with doctors and scientists, and I find it very fulfilling. So let's go back to the threat reactions and the trying. If you feel that you are trying and it's not happening, then you have an internal conflict. You have an internal conflict. And so it's time to take a step back and look at resolving the conflict. Because if you keep trying, then you keep yourself in conflict. And that's actually physically bad for you because it puts things like cortisol and adrenaline in your system. It stresses you. And it breaks your ability to succeed because there's something interfering with your success that you don't know about. So in order to be willing to be successful, you need to go find out what that is that's interfering, which is actually you, so that you can succeed.
Now, okay, again, from a business perspective, okay, Amy said she's intuitive, and there are a lot of us that are. So you're dealing with a client, and you know that a piece of you, yeah, you're trying to do everything you can to meet the client's requirements, and it's just not a happening thing. Okay, you realize, you know, part of you is not on board with whatever's going on. What are your suggestions for the best options to deal with that?
So I would say that I would recommend learning shielding, because especially if you're intuitive, you need to know shielding so that you can get the information your intuition provides without kind of getting caught up in that energy, you know, without allowing that energy to affect you. Because it's important to know the information without being influenced. And always, I got to say, always before you go into anything, let it go.
Let it go.
Always it's about let it go. And people struggle with this because how do you let it go and still be ambitious? You know, how do you let it go and still go for your goals? You want to start out by going, okay, so before I go meet this client or before I have this project, what happens if I don't get this contract? You know, what happens if it all goes south? It needs to be okay. You need to allow yourself to go through all of the mental processes of what you will do if it doesn't work, so your brain has somewhere to go. And if that means planning to choose your cardboard box to live in, let your brain go there. I'm serious. You know, it sounds, you go, well, no, you know, I'm going to make it work. Okay, that's good. Now have a backup plan, have a plan B. What if it doesn't work? Then I've got my, you know, I've saved a box from when I bought the refrigerator. I'm going to cut some holes in it for windows. It's going to be all good. I'll put a few blankets in. We're good. We're going to the curb. Allowing your brain to make that plan gives it somewhere to go so that you don't freeze up, so that you don't go into the comply chicken dance. So you have a choice. It doesn't mean you're going to go there. People say, well, you know, if you allow yourself to think about the fears, you attract the fear. Actually, if you allow yourself to solve the problem, then you're not distracted by those fears and you can focus on achievement. So it's like,
and
okay.
You can let go of the outcome.
Right. You have, it's about letting go. So if you say, okay, here's 10 different plans for if the sky falls. Okay. So now I have a plan. Good. Now I can focus. Now I can focus and do what I need to do. So lots of times when you find like you can't get the focus or you feel like everything is being difficult, it's because you've got a spin going on in the back of your head going, oh my God, what if the sky falls? So you need a plan. If the sky falls, this is what I'm going to do. Now I can get back to work. I can stop the spin. I can stop that busyness in the back of the head and get on with it. If you're trying to, no, don't be stupid. You're going to do fine. It's going to be great. We're going to, like, we, you know, we'll be able to pay the rent, all of those things. If you allow that spin to continue without addressing it, you are allowing, you know, you're allowing all this primitive fear stuff to be in charge, to be in the driver's seat, as you said earlier. So it's about recognizing these fears are real. Okay. They're real. Okay. So have a plan. Have a plan. And now get back to work.
It's like, okay, when you have children, okay, the people that care about their families tend to have a plan in case of fire. They have a route to get out of the house. Families practice, you know, this is what we do if the house goes on fire. It doesn't mean the rest of your living stops, but you know, historically, if you look at the numbers, those are the families that if ever there was a fire,
yes,
they all get out.
Yes.
There aren't, you know, there aren't issues of someone being trapped in a room because they had no idea of how to get out,
yeah,
because they had a plan in place. God willing, you know, most of them never, ever had to use that plan because they had the plan in place. And I think that's where people get stuck, and because I'm so literal, I understand the getting stuck on the languaging thing, but by not allowing yourself to get stuck in the languaging of, well, thoughts become things, you know, don't concentrate on the bad ones. No, but understand what the options are, you know, look at it, digest it, let it go. Okay. And that way you're not attached to the outcome. And whatever happens, happens. It makes life an awful lot simpler and happier.
Yes. I saw a documentary after there were a number of school shootings, and they did a documentary, and they were talking about the fact that people who had even the most rudimentary, like Boy Scout first aid training, functioned, and people who had no kind of training, you know, either went into the run around like a chicken with their head cut off or froze. And that's because the brain has no pathways. It has no path. It has nowhere to go. So one of the important things to know is you actually have to practice. So for instance, there was another show, and they were talking about how kids who'd been told don't talk to strangers would still respond because often it's an adult and an authority figure. You have to act it out. You have to act it out so that they have practice and therefore built neural pathways to do some other action besides what they're told by an adult. That's true for you too.
Yeah.
Even as adults, you have to practice and act it out so your brain has somewhere to go. Right? Even with my mother-in-law volunteers with the Red Cross, and she's often part of these, they'll do disaster training for, you know, hospitals and all kinds of things. And, you know, she gets to be a disaster victim for this.
Yeah.
And it's really important, because even people who work in emergency rooms, even the police, even, you know, all of these emergency response people, they need to act it out.
Yeah. So that the brain has somewhere to go. Emergency preparedness. And they're timed, and
right. It's everybody understands why athletes need to practice. Everybody understands why dancers or actors or whatever, they need to practice so that it will be smooth, so that it will be automatic, so that it will be natural.
And I'm going to take it one step further here. And one of my clients is a mind-body performance coach for young figure skaters. And she just recently spoke to the World Pairs Champions, which also happened to be Canadian champions, Megan and Eric, rah-rah. Her name's Rebecca. And basically, what you find in everyone that she talks to, in the kids she trains, they are actively practicing by visualizing their entire program on the ice, seeing themselves nailing the jumps, seeing themselves finishing strong, confident, you know, full of joy in completing their routine. So it isn't always just about going through the motions. You can work on visualizing these things as well.
and they've proven, speak of your scientific studies, they've proven with Olympic athletes that doing the visualization makes them stronger performers. So
absolutely.
The thing is, it's not one or the other, it's both.
Both, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. If you only, you know, I could start today and visualize the skis. It was the Olympic ski team did tons of work with the visualization. So I could start today and visualize doing those ski runs, and it would not make me able to ski because I am not good at that. However, if you do both, you do the physical and you do the visualization, both will contribute. Both will make it better. Not one or the other. Do both.
No. You have to do both.
Okay. You could visualize typing. It wouldn't make you a better typist until you actually typed.
That was a direct shot at me for anybody who doesn't know. Okay. Pat's laughing. I always say, because I'm a really crappy typist, in grade 9, I was in typing for 10 minutes, and the nun who ran the class came up, tapped me in the shoulder, and says, "My dear, go to math, go to science, go anywhere, but you don't belong here."
He did that.
So for all these years, and there have been many, many of them, I always tell people I'm a crappy typist. Basic bottom line is, I don't want to be a typist. And I know that. And guess what? I've decided I'm good with it.
So I'm actually quite a good typist. I did get kicked out by the nun, but I think I was there long enough to learn that basic finger motion, like maybe a couple of weeks. So I got the basic finger motion, then they kicked me out, so I'm good. I can touch type, and a little bit, not I wouldn't be able to do with the numbers and stuff, but the basic stuff, I got it. The thing is, it's motor memory.
Well, the funny thing is, okay, once I'm at your place trying to use your computer, she uses it so much, the S was missing. Couldn't type a damn thing. I look at the keyboard, it's like, totally lost. Cannot type.
It's like,
So I had to get a lighted keyboard. Pat will find this funny. Had to get a lighted keyboard so that the numbers won't wear off as quickly.
So, the fun part is, if I'm typing away, if I had to look for a key, I'd be in trouble. Right? I'd have to type something and think, oh, that's where my finger landed. That's where the key is. Right?
I think I probably, if I'm not thinking about it and I'm just doing things, I certainly type better than if I think about it, and then it's just terrible.
because your cognitive brain doesn't type, your brainstem types.
Uh-huh.
Right? Okay. So if you do it on automatic and let the muscle memory do it, they're going to go. If you pause and think, your cognitive brain doesn't know how to type. It's not where that skill is. Right. And so this is a fun part, because this is the part of the, you know, and that's the Karate Kid, you know, do this again until it becomes automatic. There are different parts of this. There are different things that happen for us. And part of this is understanding which bits do operate better on automatic, recognizing those, you know, saying, oh, this one's on automatic. Good. I want it. I need automatic for brushing my teeth. I don't want to be thinking like, oh, move the toothbrush up, move the toothbrush down. I'm sorry. I can pass on that. So now it's the allowing yourself to recognize, allowing yourself to know these things, and then using it. It's all about getting to choice. It's all about getting to choice.
Yeah. So as long as you remain in choice when you are with clients, prepping for clients, having anything to do with your clients, then you're good. You're not operating from fear. When you're in the driver's seat, you're making the choice, but you always have to be aware that all of you is on board. All of you
in various parts, right? So this is the thing to understand, though, is you can't just decide to be in choice. It doesn't work that way. No. You are hardwired. And so it's about building new wiring. It's about learning how to use the wiring that's in place. It's not a, oh, you know, now decide to be in choice. This takes some effort.
Okay, so how about quick suggestion for how to, besides meditating and doing unlock. Give us one more quick suggestion for getting us to the point where we are in choice.
Oh, well, here's... I want you to practice things that are outside your comfort zone. Put your fork in your other hand. Put your toothbrush in your other hand. First thing, when you go try to brush your teeth with your toothbrush in your other hand, it's going to be really, really, really annoying. And I want you to notice that, how irritating, how much it slows you down, how difficult it is to brush your teeth with your toothbrush in your other hand. Pause and own that to understand that's how hard it is to go outside your comfort zone.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. Okay. That's how hard it is. So know that first, like recognize it. Like, this is really a pain. That's how hard it is to do something different in any area. So like different, make more money, different, anything, like anything that's outside your norm is that difficult. So feel that, recognize it. Okay. And then if you're willing, if you do brush your teeth with your other hand in about 6 weeks, it'll be easy. It'll be automatic because you'll have built the neural pathways, okay? Which means you really can change it, and it really can be easy to live in a different state. Having that experience teaches you to be safer with change.
Ooh. That's good.
It is. So simple and easy, no meditation required.
Oh, there we go. Simple and easy, no meditation required. Woohoo.
Just about brushing your teeth or eating with the fork in the other hand. Pretty simple. Most people do it.
Except those whose teeth are like stars.
Yes. You still have a fork.
That's true. That's true. Practice with your fork in the other hand.
Yes.
Well, it's funny because as a child, I don't know why I did it, simply because I found out that there were people who would write with both hands. And that fascinated me.
So you had to go do it.
I made myself. Well, of course. I wanted to be ambidextrous.
Of course I did.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not as tidy, but when I broke my right arm, it was great because I could still, yeah. Really? Well, I don't mean it was great that I broke my arm. I mean, it was great that I could use my left hand.
Well, and so there's another, and I hesitate to say this one because I wouldn't do this because it would interfere with my work. I'd rather do it like with the fork, is you could move your mouse to the other side.
Ooh, yeah.
But okay, yeah. The thing is, I'm usually, when I'm working, I'm focused on what I'm doing. I don't want to play games with my mouse. So fork, use the fork.
Well, oh, and it's funny when I go to clients, when I'm helping certain clients, I'll be using their computers. And I have some clients that are very into, well, left-handed, but also gamers.
Ah.
So they use a trackball.
Yes.
Instead of a mouse.
Yes.
That takes some getting used to.
I really like the trackball. I prefer the trackball.
Oh, do you?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, I don't. Yeah,
I do.
Well, I think I probably, you know what? Maybe I'll try it. My mouse is annoying me these days, so maybe I'll try something different.
Well, and I'm a big believer in, you know, if you've been doing the same thing for a while, change it up. Because if you use a trackball, your wrist is moving differently, your hand is moving differently, right? All these things. So you want to be good.
Yeah. Well, I used to use a Wacom tablet because I have the pen too.
Yes. Yes.
And I love that. Maybe I'll switch back to that for a while.
Yeah. And it's change it up, right? Change it up.
Yeah.
Get those,
change is as good as a rest.
Yep, get those wires going.
Absolutely. So we're going to start wrapping up now.
Okay.
Basically, we've looked at, you know, give up on the trying, there's that word again. If you make a habit of being aware that you're present. So for me, that's live in the moment. Like, be there, whatever you're doing. even if it's brushing your teeth with your left hand or using a fork with the left hand, or, you know, interacting with your clients or being focused on a project, whatever it is that you're doing, be 100% present and you will actually catch your reactions faster.
Yes.
Because you won't allow yourself to go down that rabbit hole and, right. and, you know, find yourself nowhere near your driver's seat. It used to be a lot harder.
Well, and back to, if you're willing, notice what you're feeling. If you're frustrated, if you're irritated, if you're angry, if you're finding things take too long, if you're finding that you're checked out or you're bored or you're distracted, all of those are reactions. All of those are messages. Your subconscious speaks to you through your body, through your emotions. If you're feeling bored, if you're feeling distracted, if you're feeling tired, your subconscious is telling you that you have internal conflicts to resolve, and you can resolve them and basically get out of your own way.
And you used to say, and a way to tell when you were no longer in choice is if whatever's going on, whatever you're thinking about, you know, in the case of my husband, it would be sports. You know, when you're upset about a sport, or you're, you know, overjoyed about a sport, or you're feeling one way or the other, you realize you're not neutral.
Yes.
Right? And yes. And when you're neutral, then you have choice.
Right. And you can learn to make choice even when you're in that emotion state.
Yeah.
Because
you got to start.
You have to start somewhere, and the starting place is recognizing those the emotions that are influencing you, so that, you know, you can basically work to the place where you can be aware of the emotion and still make a clean choice. You know, this is emotion. I know that's going on. I still make a decision, right?
Okay. I like it. I like it. Ability to be in choice.
Right. Even. So emotion is information. It's the information coming from your subconscious. The typical norm is the emotion has a lot of influence on your behavior, a lot of influence on, you know, what you're thinking and what you're doing. And basically self-mastery is all about understand the emotion, know how to work with the emotion, and it's simply information.
Right. Whoa, that's awesome. Awesome. I think that's a super note to end on for today.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone, for being with us. Thank you, Trish, the Holistic Missile, for once again, bam, 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 slamming it to us with some really thought-provoking stuff. There are so many things that you can get from Trish's meditations and her other information at ttloinc.com. I'm your digital person, truelsocial.com. That's me. As I say every Monday, we will see you again next week. Well, thank you, Amy and Pat and everyone who's with us today.
Thank you.
And we will see you next Monday. Blab time, same blab channel. Had to get that in there.
Yep. We'll be doing topics about goals all through May.
All through May. We're on about goals, but stay tuned for more.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.